So today, the Rising Asia Foundation is launching the Rising Asia Journal at a historical moment of continental change in order to cast a scholarly eye on the past and the present of Asia, its societies, its cultures, its convergences, its divergences, and to make sense of its civilizational legacies. The continent Asia is facing an exquisite new dilemma. A new Asian century appears to be in the making, just 2 decades after the demise of the older one. The engine driving the original Asian century, with China carrying a disproportionate burden, sputtered and choked soon after its excessively ballyhooed emergence. Our dilemma will center on gleaning the correct lessons from its failure. It was a 20-year period of global turmoil that exposed the fissures running deep within the continent where war and the threat of war hung over the region with worrying imminence. A disturbing foreboding of conflict simmers within multiple cauldrons, those of the Himalayas, the South China Sea, Taiwan, and the East Sea, whose storied histories of conflict have resurfaced to torpedo prospects of lasting peace and stability. The formation of a new Asian order appears to have begun. It may not be led by a single hegemonic power, but by a continent in the making, but by an entente, a continental entente of a number of Asian countries. But the trouble is that this is a deeply contested order. By definition, a global or Asian order implies a political concert in which countries no longer divided because of their support for either the United States or China, like in present times, agree to work together to solve international and regional problems. A new Asian order is certainly taking shape because Asian states desire a continent where no single hegemonic power gets to determine the land and maritime borders and make expansive and peremptory territorial claims. A new Asian order and a new Asian century must be inclusive and must give voice to all states, large or small, fairly and equally. The Rising Asia and its parent, the Rising Asia Foundation, are a part of the Rising Asia Foundation Trust, which is a non-profit organization registered in Calcutta, West Bengal, in October last year, with the aim of bringing together scholars, diplomats, multilateral organization experts, and business persons with a mandate to publish scholarly journals and books and to be dedicated to the study of Asian societies. The mission of the organization is to promote excellence in the scholarship, teaching, and presentation of all aspects of Asia, and to encourage the wide discussion of scholarly questions and the fair treatment of all practitioners of multidisciplinary teaching and research. The Rising Asia Foundation is supported through the donations of philanthropists, memberships, and subscription fees, and from revenue from its annual conferences. The Rising Asia Journal serves as a resource for the study, investigation, and teaching of Asian societies, as I've said. Each volume of the journal will contain interpretive essays on all aspects of Asian history, economy, diplomacy, literature, health science, military affairs, war, peace and society, and culture. Its coverage spans the humanities and social sciences, incorporating various thematic approaches of which are historical, economic, foreign policy oriented, military, literary, and theoretical, that explore issues of grand strategy, ideology, ethnicity, race and gender, diasporic and indigenous communities, colonialism, and the post-colonial experience. The RAJ and the RAF thank the distinguished entrepreneur Ashwini Kakkar for his generous donation, which has made it possible to publish. Ashwini is a scholar and thinker. He has served as executive vice chairman of Mercury Travels and chairman of Wire.com. And he was knighted by the French government with the Chevalier d'Ordre Mérite in 2007 in recognition for his services which span borders. Rising Asia Foundation is led by its founder president, Mr. Sitaram Sharma, who is the honorary consul general of Belarus in Calcutta, and the former chairman of the Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad Institute of Asian Studies, which is a Government of India think tank. The foundation itself, as I've said, was created by the Rising Asia Foundation Trust, which is managed by its founder trustee and chairman, which is myself, the founder trustee, Bijalpita Julie Mehta, and the trustees, the two of them, the entrepreneur and the cinema and theater actor, Sumit Ray, and the author and graduate student, Raka Mukherjee. So we've ensured that age, youth, and gender are properly represented across the trust, as well as across our editorial board and our board of advisors. So that continuity, stability, and longevity are ensured. The RAF's board of advisors is drawn from scholars and business persons, and we are delighted to present today some of our editorial board members, of accomplished scholars from across the disciplines, from history and economics to conflict studies, diplomacy, and literature. They come to us from universities and institutions in the United States, in Canada, in Singapore, Vietnam, Cambodia, and India. And I guess in the future, this can only grow. I welcome you to today's program. Thank you and enjoy. So right in the beginning of our program, I have the distinct pleasure of welcoming our founding president, Mr. Sitaram Sharma, who is the honorary consul general of the Republic of Belarus in Calcutta. And he's a former chairman of the Maulana Abul Kalam Azad Institute for Asian Studies, also in Calcutta. He's the author of several books on the United Nations and on Bengal, and he's been a journalist for several years now. So with those brief comments, I hand you over to Mr. Sharma for his comments.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. I think the launching of a think tank, rather one more think tank, is particularly in the city of Kolkata at the dawn of new year, is a very welcome addition to the city of Kolkata. As we all know, the 21st century belongs to Asia. And my interest further deepened when I took over as the director of Asia-Pacific Regional Office of the World Federation of United Nations Association, Geneva. My assignment was to coordinate the programs and activities of over 50 UN associations in Asia-Pacific region. During my long tenure of 16 years, I traveled across the region and organized Asia-Pacific regional conferences in New Delhi, Ulaanbaatar, Mongolia, Tokyo, Japan, New Delhi, Dhaka, Bangladesh, Beijing, China, and Bangkok. Now, my active participation in the UN conferences on the Indian Ocean, a zone of peace, attended by about 45 permanent representatives to the UN of over 45 countries in Sochi, USSR, and then at the world's largest conference of NGOs organized by the Department of Public Information, United Nations. So what I was where, and in this conference, I was not only the convener of the tripartite committee, but also chief rapporteurs. These experiences further cemented my conviction about creating a forum for Asia-Pacific region to discuss and deliberate on equal footing about the regional issues as the protection of the peace and human rights, disarmament, economic development, and promotion of cultural and academic exchanges. I would like our foundation and the journal to take initiative and a lead, adopting a very flexible and gradual approach. I think organizing the loose style of conferences might be suitable at the start, drawing on the strength of the NGOs. Our emphasis should not be only on the economic and the security issues, but also on educational and the cultural perspectives. We need to work together. To borrow a phrase from Mr. Joseph Nye, soft power is not competitive power, but rather cooperative power. Let some of our programs be our campaign, our logo, our goal. Let us mobilize support for a need of a United Nations regional headquarters in Asia, preferably in Delhi or anywhere else in India. Now, if we take up these each goals and work for them, it will be counted as our achievement. I think we should also institute an award on behalf of our foundation, particularly either in the field of environment or human rights. We are almost on the eve of achieving the dream of an Asian century. And let our foundation and journal not only be an observer, but an active partner in this journey to the Asian century.
Joining us from Calcutta, India, is Dr. Julie Mehta, who is a member of the journal's editorial board, and she's a founding trustee. Julie was selected as one of the 16 most influential Asian Canadians in Canada, and she is an author and a specialist on Cambodia and Asian cultures in the diaspora, and a translator of Tagore's play and poetry. Julie's play called The Dark Ghar, The Post Office, was successfully performed in Toronto a few years ago, successfully, and it was put up by the Pleiades Theatre Company. Julie is a well-published author and a scholar with a large cachet of journal articles and book chapters and books and a forthcoming novel, which would be her first.
What a privilege to celebrate the launch of the Rising Asia Journal and the Rising Asia Foundation. I'm Julie Mehta and have watched the conceptualization and transformation of the idea of the initiative in my partner, Dr. Harish Mehta's mind, and then see it being transformed from page to stage. For three decades and more, where you've studied, lived, and worked in several nations of South and Southeast Asia, including Thailand, Singapore, Vietnam, in Canada, and the United States. The books we published on Cambodia separately and as collaborative projects took us to North America, where I realized the seismic event that punctuated the young diasporic Asian immigrants who were scholars of American and Canadian universities and hungry to know about their left behind homelands. Later, with a PhD degree from the University of Toronto on English and South Asian studies, as I began to teach the Chancellor Emerita and Senator Vivian Poi Endowed Program on Asian Literatures and Cultures in Canada, I began to feel the thrill that many of my young students felt to learn and connect with Asia, the homes that were just stories that came to life by the narratives these scholars had learned from their parents or grandparents. As a translator and author, I delighted in straddling both the language of the colonized and the colonizer. And now I have a finger on the dual pulse of a global chutneyfied identity most youth are privileged to have as inheritors today. The reemergence of Asia is among the most important shifts. Now, Asia is at the heart of the action for multilateral trade liberalization. Asians are an increasingly important segment of Canadian and American societies. Asia has about 60% of the world's population with different historical traditions, cultures, and religions. Three of the four most populous countries of the world are in Asia, China, India, and Indonesia. US trade with Asia was twice that with Europe in 1996. During the 19th century, the whole world's economy, the center of their economy, shifted westward from Europe to North America. During the 20th century, the world's economy's center has gradually moved from North America to the Asia Pacific. A huge number of US corporations conduct business in Asia today, despite the pandemic. The editor-in-chief of the Rising Asia Foundation, Harish, is possibly the most exposed, accomplished, and compelling scholar and specialist who has the global experience and vision to bring Asia to the world and the world to Asia. The expert pool of academics and Asia specialists who are contributors and writers and the editorial board are all in sync with Harish's ideas to make this journal as accessible and excellent as any in the arena. Bringing Asia home to the world is my way to describe it. For someone like Harish, who has been the editor-in-chief of other frontline academic journals and has an enviable cachet of awards and winnings in the world of global journalism and pedagogy, this now is a labor of pure love. For me, it has been a remarkable journey, crisscrossing the borderlands of communities and cultures that make Asia in their diasporic spaces and forge their identities constantly as a part of the multicultural tossed salad they are in Canada and the United States. To have had the opportunity to bring the diaspora to Kolkata and work as a professor for my alma mater, Loreto College, is life's great blessing. So the outreach of this journal and foundation to my graduate students here in Loreto College who are copy editors on this publication, the many friends such as Global Souls and renowned creative talents such as Lata Pada, Judy Fong Bates, Gurjeet Singh, Raj Sharma, Suchorita Chattopadhyay, to name a few, And to many scholars, corporates such as Urijit Ghosh, bureaucrats, academics, has been a most exciting outcome of this enterprise. I wish Rising Asia Journal and Foundation a long, long ride to the galaxy. Keep rising.
So coming to us all the way from Campbellford on a farm just outside Toronto, the Alpha City of Canada, is the acclaimed and well-published novelist, the Chinese-Canadian novelist Judy Fong Bates, whose book Midnight at the Dragon Cafe has won so many awards already, as well as her couple of other novels. Judy came from at the age of five, she left Guangdong province in China with her mother to join her father, who already was working in Canada. So with those brief words, I leave you with Judy Fong Bates.
Greetings from Canada, from snowy Campbellford, where it's sub-zero and where the landscape is covered with snow. As Harish said, my name is Judy Fong Bates. I'm a writer, and I was born in China, and I came to Canada at age five. I think because of that, I am a person of the West, albeit I have Chinese roots. When I was 55, I believe, I returned to China after a 50-year absence. And on that journey, I reconnected with family and I got to know China. And then there were subsequent journeys. And out of that journey came a family memoir, The Year of Finding Memory. And since then, I have returned to China several times. And I've also been to India, where I have stayed with the Mehtas in their lovely home in Calcutta. Until those visits to Asia, China especially, but all of Asia, was something that I had only read about in books. And it was a place that was really far away and was not a part of my immediate world. And what I'd like to say is that with the publication of Rising Asia, which I think is going to be a wonderful, wonderful publication, I think that this publication, this journal, will give us a fresh perspective on Asia and on all those issues that are old and new and that we in the West really need to be paying a lot more attention to. When I met the Mehtas in Toronto, they were both graduate students, I think, pursuing doctoral studies at local universities, and they were also teaching. What was interesting to me about the Mehtas was that they had left incredibly successful careers in journalism. And I think it takes a lot of courage to turn your back on something like that and to pursue something so totally new. And what I remember was going to visit them and having wonderful meals. But more than anything else, I remember sitting around the table and discussing issues and whetting my appetite to go to Asia and to go to India. And I think that was, in a way, the awakening of a desire to see that part of the world. And I'm really hoping, and I've read only a few of the articles so far from Rising Asia, but I really am hoping that this will be a magazine that will give the West a new perspective on what is happening in Asia. And here in Canada, our gaze has mostly been to the south, to that large elephant that lives beside us south of the border. And I think that in the past 4 years, it's been even more so. And I really feel that, I don't know if I should speak for all Canadians, but in many ways, I think that Asia is a place that I've always just watched from the corner of my eye. And with the rise of China and India, and of course, we all know that China is considered the workshop of the world. And I only recently found out that India produces almost all of the world's vaccines. So I think that that's another prime example of looking at Asia from the corner of my eye. And I'm really feeling that with this magazine, that it will help the West direct its gaze much more directly on Asia. And I think that that is something that's really needed, because we need to balance our gaze and we need to balance our attention. And so with those words, I would like to offer my congratulations to Harish and to Sitaram Sharma. And I wish you much success with Rising Asia. Congratulations. When I first went back to China in 2006, I really went as a tourist, in spite of the fact that I was going back to my homeland and to the place where I was born. And what was interesting about China was that I was going to a place where I looked like the people all around me, but it was so obvious that I wasn't from there anymore, that I was Canadian. I think that I really stood out. It's a vast country, and where I'm from is just a very tiny corner of China, and I suppose I feel that I know that part a little bit better. But there is so much of China that is vast, and I think for someone like me, and for perhaps many people, it's unknowable. I think that when a country is that large, it's just hard to grasp. In the same way, I suppose that Canada is also unknowable, because again, its vast geographical size. It's hard for me to grasp what it's like in Baffin Island, you know, because I live in basically urban Canada. And so in that same way, I feel those same feelings about China. I think I was really impressed by the industry that was there. The people there are incredibly hardworking. My relatives were incredibly warm. And because I speak Chinese, I speak the local dialect, we were able to communicate. But I really did feel that there was a divide. And yet on the other hand, because of our humanity, we were able to bridge that divide, because we are relatives. And they treated me so warmly, and they welcomed me into their homes. And I found out stories about my family that I would not have known otherwise. So it was for me, going back to China, a journey of many conflicts, but it was a journey that opened up my eyes and expanded my horizons. I am working on two projects. One is a historical piece and the other is a more contemporary piece. I'm hoping that they will get off the ground, but we will have to see.
So coming to us from Washington, D.C. is the former war correspondent in Cambodia for the Washington Post, Elizabeth Becker. And she has been foreign policy correspondent for the New York Times. The Pulitzer Prize-winning author is currently also a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. Elizabeth Becker's best known for her work on the Vietnam War and Cambodia, where she served as a foreign correspondent during the war years. And her books are selling to the day. She continues to write, as her latest book, Overbooked, will show us. So with that very brief introduction, I hand you over to Elizabeth Becker.
Hello, and it's so wonderful to be here. I'm in Washington, D.C., 2 days before the inauguration of Joe Biden as president and Kamala Harris as vice president. And it should be an amazing celebration of who the United States is. Instead, I live 3 blocks from the Capitol, and it is as if I am in an armed camp. We had an insurrection against our government on the 6th of January, and to prevent more destruction, where we have 20,000 soldiers. It's especially upsetting because the Vice President Kamala Harris is a daughter of India. Her mother, Shyamala Gopalan Harris, was born in Chennai, I almost said Madras, and I was a student of India. To me, that's something so much to celebrate, and it's so heartbreaking that my country is at the crossroads it is at. And I think that's why it's especially fun for me to be talking to you, because your mission is to look at the new Asian order in a broad sense, not a, aren't we cool, India, or isn't Asia going to outdo America? It is to look at us, the whole world, through the humanities, through the arts, to help explain how Kamala Harris could be the vice president of the United States. You couldn't have asked me to talk at a better time. Now, how did I become a student of India? And this is one of the reasons I'm so happy to talk to you in Calcutta. When I was a 16-year-old, didn't know what I was doing in high school, I had a wonderful teacher who gave me a book of the short stories of Rabindranath Tagore. And I'd never heard of him. I had no idea where Calcutta was. But several of his stories eventually put me on the path to studying India in my college years. And that led me to Cambodia and my career. And all through my career, I have tried to look at how my country, the United States, looks at Asia. So in Cambodia, I watched my country, saturation bombing of Cambodia, a country I grew to love. I continued reporting and writing it, going from journalist to author. So I wrote a book called When the War Was Over, Cambodia and the Khmer Rouge Revolution, which is a history and a political analysis of how they came to power. And my country, of course, had a huge impact on that, pulling it into the Vietnam War. But I can't just say it's because of the United States or because of this or that. You can't just take someone like Pol Pot and say, oh, he was a madman and America's responsible. No, I had to spend years making sure that I looked at all the tendrils, the arts, the humanities, the politics, everything you put in Asia Rising. So I immediately felt, gosh, this is a great place. And it was also interesting because Cambodia is a Sanskritized country. That's what we used to call it in academics. You had Sinicized, the countries who were influenced by China, the ones interested by India. And I found in my work as a journalist, there was still the attitude in the United States that India was a, quote, third world country, that it was suspicious because it looked for that neutral place that you all celebrate in your mission statement, that it was part of the non-aligned movement, which they thought was a dodge for the Soviet Union. And there was no space for anything but by that bipolar world. But it was also diminishing and refusing to acknowledge what Asia had already contributed to the world. And that's also part of what my work is. So I did When the War Was Over about the genocide of Cambodia, continued writing. And as the international economics correspondent of the New York Times, I covered globalization as the whole world opens up. And then I thought, oh, good, this is going to be when we all start to understand each other and we're going to be no longer bipolar. Well, it became messy. And one of the things that I found interesting was in international economics, I thought, well, one of the industries that is going to really take off and help us understand each other is tourism. So I, when I left full-time journalism, I did an investigation of global tourism. And I was expecting to find all these wonderful stories of people understanding people. And instead, I found a story of, believe it or not, rapacious global industries. And too often, tourism became a problem rather than a positive part of the world. And in there are good examples. I'm not saying there aren't, but the industry had escaped regulation as so much had during globalization. And I realized just how difficult this was going to be. So that book, Overbooked, The Exploding Business of Travel and Tourism, talked about places like the Taj Mahal, some of the good stories like Bhutan, and tried to give a global view of this. And I found in that a lot of what was the best, what usually saved a country, was if they had already had a strong sense of the humanities and of the arts, so that if you were a country that looked at the whole arts and humanities, you were more likely than not to have a good tourism. So again, Asia Rising. Now I just finished a book called You Don't Belong Here. And this is a look at women and how we have changed as reporters. You Don't Belong Here is about three women who covered the Vietnam War, the American Frankie Fitzgerald, the Australian Kate Webb, and the French photographer Catherine Leroy. It's coming out at the end of February. And the difference that the women make, besides opening up the field for other women, was that they intuitively covered the people who were being hurt by the war, the Vietnamese, the Cambodians. They were as outsiders who shouldn't have belonged there, they made it a point to say, okay, this is what's going on in Vietnam. This is how the Vietnamese are being affected. This is what it means. And they didn't avoid politics or the actual destruction at all, hardly, but they opened up that avenue and they won a lot of awards. But again, it was very hard for what they did to be celebrated. And that's the ups and downs of all of that. And so that's who I am. This continues to be my focus. How does America find its footing in the new Asian order? And I congratulate you on your journal.
Coming to us from Singapore is Professor Ang Cheng Guan, who's a member of our editorial board and associate professor at the Rajaratnam School of International Studies. Professor Cheng Guan.
The title of this new journal is most timely and also most appropriately named. There's a general agreement that for quite some years already, the center of global economic activity has been shifting towards Asia. It has been said that if the 19th century belonged to Europe, the 20th century to the United States, the 21st century belonged to Asia. We are now into the second decade of the 21st century. The title Asia Rising, on the one hand, exudes a positive and optimistic note, if not celebratory, especially when one compares the present with the region's colonial past, as well as the divisions in the Cold War period. Asia broadly is indeed rising. The title, on the other hand, also reminds us that Asia hasn't risen yet, and its rise is not necessarily inexorable or inevitable. The journal, I expect, help readers understand what makes Asia tick from multiple and connected perspectives in the face of global uncertainties and new challenges, provides fresh analysis and insights into a very sizable, highly complex and diverse region. For myself, who is a historian of contemporary Southeast Asia, I'm particularly interested in how Southeast Asia fits into this Asia Rising narrative. It is also important that even as we focus on the present and look towards the future, we should remember that he who confines the thought to the present time will not understand present reality.
And coming to us from Malibu, California, from Pepperdine University, is Professor Tuan Huang. He is a professor there of great books. Tuan lives there, and his specialization is on Vietnamese communism, Vietnamese nationalism, and Vietnamese Catholicism. He has a large repertoire of book chapters and books which are forthcoming, and of course several book chapters, as I said, in important publications in the United States, as well as journal articles. So with that, I hand you over to Tuan.
Hello from Southern California. My name is Tuan Huang. It is a Vietnamese name. And I am associate professor at Pepperdine University, which is in Malibu, California, not very far from Los Angeles. I am honored to be invited by Harish, the editor-in-chief, to join the editorial board, and I look forward to the work there. My own research, my own scholarship has focused generally on two related areas. First is modern Vietnamese history, intellectual history, religious history, particularly. I also have been working on the history of Vietnamese refugees in the U.S. Specifically, the Vietnamese Catholic refugees. And so lately, my research in the last 3 years. Has been on primarily religious history, specifically the history of Catholicism, in Vietnam and also among refugee communities in the U.S. after the fall of Saigon. Very exciting research, and I look forward for more. And I also look forward to participate in the editorial board, reading manuscripts, reviewing. Perhaps writing a review now and then, and commentary and things like that. I sense a lot of energy on the part of the editor-in-chief, on the part of, Rising Asia Journal. And I look forward to be participating more fully. All right, take care now. Bye-bye.
So coming to us from Harvard University in Cambridge, Massachusetts, is Dr. Craig Etchison, who is also a member of our editorial board, and he's a visiting scientist at the T.H. Chan School at Harvard University. He's a specialist on Cambodia and Cambodian history, politics, and genocide. With those very brief comments, And of course, his books are path-breaking books, which are highly valued. So with those very brief comments, I would welcome Professor Etchison to make his remarks.
Thank you, Harish. It's a great honor to be with all of you this morning to launch the Rising Asia Journal. Readers of the inaugural issue of the journal will note that the bulk of the pieces in this first issue center around India. But I can assure readers that Rising Asia will in the future cover Asia quite broadly, in East Asia, Southeast Asia, South Asia, and all of the connections beyond. Perhaps an indication of that in this first issue is an excerpt from my 2019 book, Extraordinary Justice, Law, Politics, and the Khmer Rouge Tribunals, which covers processes of retributive justice in Cambodia following the reign of the Khmer Rouge. So that is perhaps a signpost in this first issue, indicating that its future scope will go far beyond India itself. My current research concerns how societies are reconstructed after severe socio-political upheaval. I think this has a broad applicability across much of Asia today, from East Timor, Indonesia, Vietnam, Cambodia, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Afghanistan, Sri Lanka, and perhaps other places as well. I have developed a model of 10 different categories of what I call mechanisms or techniques that are used to help knit the social fabric of torn societies back together. These include things such as legal techniques, which could include restorative justice, such as truth commissions, or retributive justice, such as criminal tribunals, and 9 other categories of mechanisms that are used in an attempt to restore civility and social peace after conflict in a country. My main focus in this new study will be on Cambodia, which since 1979 has seen all 10 of these different mechanisms applied, some of them repeatedly, in an effort to see which ones of those have been successful in attempting to restore a country's peace and security, which ones have not, and why. So that's the work I'm focused on now here at Harvard.
So coming to us from New Delhi is Ambassador Gurjeet Singh, who's a member of editorial board of Rising Asia Journal, and he's a former ambassador of India to Germany, Indonesia, ASEAN, Timor-Leste, Ethiopia, and Djibouti. Julie and I have known Ambassador Gurjeet Singh from his college days. Julie, of course, much longer, from his college days in St. Xavier's, Calcutta. So with that brief introduction, and of course, he's an author of interesting books. And so with those brief words, I hand it over to Ambassador Gurjeet Singh.
Thank you very much, Dr. Harish Mehta, Dr. Julie Mehta. I compliment your intense passion and work towards creating the new Rising Asia Journal. And to all your team, my hearty congratulations. I think this is the journal much needed. First, it comes out of Kolkata. You know, nowadays all foreign policy wonks seem to be in Delhi. But I'm so happy that you are doing this out of Kolkata. And you are looking east. Just as the government of India is not only looking east, but acting east. So I think you are the right people in the right place, doing the right thing at the right time. Asia, I think, has got more than its share of attention right now. The fulcrum of the world seems to have moved here. While some countries may or may not pivot, the fact that Asia is the center of what's happening in the world is fairly clear. So whether you have the Indo-Pacific or you have the trade agreements like the RCEP, the TPP, now heading to the free trade area for the Asia-Pacific. So the entire program of the world's strategic alliances, the attention, the functional collaboration, and the trade and investment, of course, the new resilient value chains, everything is focused on Asia. So in Asia, on one hand, we have India, which is like a gateway at this end. And we are, at least in North India, feeling quite cold and chilly. At the other end, you have Japan, where I think they're also freezing. But in between, you have the eastern, northeastern India, the ASEAN countries, which are really the warm heart of Asia. And I think that is where much of the activity happens. I have been fortunate to have been posted in Japan twice, in Sri Lanka, and in Indonesia, and traveled to many ASEAN countries when I was ambassador to ASEAN. Two of my books have actually been on Asia. The first one, called The Abalone Factor, was actually on India and Japan. And the later one, called Masala Bumbu, was on India and Indonesia. I continue to have an abiding interest in focusing on India's relations to the East with Asia. And I write frequently on it, as I have for the first issue of the Rising Asia Journal. I hope with my little understanding of this area, I can gain more from my interaction with all the colleagues on the Rising Asia Journal Advisory Committee and Board. And I look forward to contributing to building understanding and bridges in the years ahead. My best wishes on your success.
Dr. Professor Sanjay Kathuria, who's a member of our editorial board of the Rising Asia Journal and a senior visiting fellow at the Center for Policy Research, a former lead economist at the World Bank, and an adjunct professor at the Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service, and an adjunct professor at India's Ashoka University. Sanjay has published very widely on regional and sub-regional economic and trade issues spanning South Asia and other parts of the world. He continues to write on South Asia, but his policy prescriptions have a wider impact than just South Asia. So with that, I hand you over to Sanjay from Fulton, Maryland.
Thank you very much, Dr. Harish Mehta. I am absolutely thrilled to be a part of this new venture, the Rising Asia Journal, as part of the broader Rising Asia Foundation. I'm very happy because this is an interdisciplinary journal. We're already, as we know, in an Asian century. And this journal will help keep us abreast of key geoeconomic changes in arguably the most significant continent of the 21st century. So I am very happy to be part of this work. As Harish said, I work on South Asia. I've been doing so for over the last decade. I work on South Asia and the linkages between South Asia and East Asia, or actually the lack of linkages between the two, because the links are very poor. I worked for 27 years at the World Bank. As I said, the last 9 years of which were in South Asia. I am also working on similar issues at the Center for Policy Research on trade, globalization, competitiveness for India as a whole, for South Asia, and for the Northeast region of India, because that's the crucial fulcrum for linkages between the Northeast and East Asia, and is part of India's now well-known Act East policy. The reason I'm also interested in Asia, or you know, as a South Asian on East Asia, is that there is a lot that India and South Asia can learn from East Asia's economic policy, their embrace of regional and global value chains, and their focus on human development. So I think we have a lot to learn in South Asia. So I'm happy to be also looking at East Asia from that sort of learning lens. And finally, as Harish said, I am now in this sort of new venture, new part of my life and career. I'm going to be very soon, in a week, I'm going to start teaching in both Georgetown and Ashoka on a course on South Asia. And I'm very thrilled and excited. And I'll be bringing in many of the things that I've just mentioned into that course. And I'll be talking about why a regional approach, or embracing an inter-regional approach within South Asia, is very important for all the economies of South Asia, and also important for how it approaches the rest of the continent, namely East Asia, from which it has a lot to gain, both economically as well as linking it strategically and through connectivity. So once again, my congratulations to Dr. Harish Mehta and the entire team for this amazing venture, which I'm absolutely thrilled to be part of, and I look forward to its unfolding in the coming months and years. Congratulations.
So coming to us all the way from Phnom Penh, Cambodia, is Dr. Leng Sochia, who is an advisor to the chairman of the Cambodian National Election Commission and permanent vice chairman of the governing council of the Cambodia Mine Action Center in Phnom Penh. And Dr. Leng Sochia is holding both ranks, which are of ministerial position. I have known him for more than 30 years during my travels to Vietnam and Cambodia, along with Professor Julie Mehta. So I hand it over to you, Dr. Sochia, to give your remarks.
Yes, thank you. My name is Leng Sochia. I'm from Cambodia. I live in Phnom Penh. I work as a senior official of the Royal Government of Cambodia. I am an advisor to the chairman of the Cambodian National Election Committee, as well as I work as the chairman of the Cambodian Mine Action Center. I have known Dr. Professor Harris and Julie for more than 30 years, yes. And they are visited, stay in Cambodia as correspondent of Singapore Business Times. I'm very happy to be involved with Dr. Harris and the new journal. I'm delighted that Rising Asia Journal and Rising Asia Foundation are being launched today. The new journal are making an important contribution to the scholarly research focusing exclusively on the East. It has raised the level of intellectual discussion, debate, research, and analysis. The first issue features an impressive collection of the research articles and a fine list of the author. It will be a valuable resource for the researcher and the influential publication avenue for the author. I warmly welcome the charitable work that Rising Asia Foundation plan to do, as well as its conferences. Taking this opportunity, I would like to draw your attention to my input for the mine action sector. Almost 30 years of the prolonged war in Cambodia left behind with millions of different types of landmines from different countries were laid in this war-torn nation. And as the result, there are more than 64,500 victims, of which 30% of was killed instantly on spot. It is a hard burden of the government undertaken so far, especially the impact on the social economy. If we are looking to the current mind map in Cambodia, you will notice that 7 provinces on the eastern province of Cambodia covered mostly by U.S. air raid bombing between 1965 to 1975, with the amount of 2.7 million ton, especially the impact on the social economy. And if we look back to the west, we can see the five provinces were led by millions of landmines there. Related to the mine action baseline survey indicated the national mine action strategy 2018 and 2025 state that there are more than 1,970 square kilometers is needed to be cleared by 2025 deadline, which $406 million budget requirement. Related to my education background, I was graduated by my PhD by choosing the topic of the thesis in factor influencing effective management of the mining in Cambodia. The reason is that there are a rare author writing deep in mine action in Cambodia. That's the deadline of the 2025, the mine free world goal awaiting us. I also work in the field of the mine action since the year of 2000. And as of today, I work this sector for 21 years. I got a lot of experience and know-how in my head. So why I better to share my knowledge to the government, to the mine action provider, and development partner. I'm also writing to journal to the for the Asia Europe University for book and online publication, and 3 journal for the Calcutta Journal of Global Affairs in 2019 and 2020. I've also attended many workshops, seminars, and conferences on my action here and abroad. Thank you for your attention.
Now coming to us from Mizoram, from the city of Aizawl, is Professor Jang Khongam Dongle, who is from the Department of Political Science at Mizoram University. And I have had a long association with him regarding journals. We have worked together in the past on other committees. And his expertise in India's Northeast is extremely valuable. And he heads a number of influential committees nationally and internationally in India and abroad. So with those words, I very warmly welcome Professor Dongle to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Harish Mehta. And I'm thankful to all my editorial board colleagues who attend this program. And this evening, this auspicious program for inauguration of Rising Asia is possible only due to the contribution, hard work of Dr. Harish Mehta. At the very outset, I would like to congratulate him and also Julie Mehta and all those who are with him in bringing out the Zollner in this manner and for organizing this auspicious program. And as we know, as we are in Asia, we have to promote the region. So there are many virgin areas which have not yet been known by outside world in different parts of Asia in different parts of North India, and particularly Northeast India also. And as academician and as people in the field, I feel that it is our responsibility to publicize it and to make it known to outside world through these results and publication. And I think that very purpose will be served by this Rising Asia. And so being in the editorial board, and I've been associated with Dr. Harish Mehta from the past, and from my part, I'll do my level best so that this journal will grow and this journal will prosper. And thank you so much. Let me conclude here. Let's all work together for progress and for further development of the journal. Thank you so much.
So coming to us from Calcutta is our esteemed member of the Board of Advisors to the Rising Asia Foundation, Mr. Arijit Ghosh, who is a graduate of the St. Stephen's College in Delhi. And then he went on to pursue a very excellent and wide-ranging career with the global giant Unilever, working as its vice president in India, in Singapore, Vietnam, China, and Dubai. So Mr. Ghosh has considerable experience across Asia, and specifically in Southeast Asia and East Asia, where he's lived for many, many years. So with those comments, I shall request Arijit to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. What I would really like to start with is, the Rising Asia Foundation and the Rising Asia Journal are absolutely on point in terms of where the world is today. Since the turn of the century, it has almost become obligatory to call this the Asian century. 20 years down the path from the turn of the millennium, most markers set out at the turn are being met or indeed exceeded. Of course, the irony is this is not the first Asian century. Asia accounted for more than half the world's economic output for 18 of the last 20 centuries. So in a sense, this century is a restoration of Asia's position in the world order. The massive concentration of capital in the West, coupled with the Industrial Revolution and colonialism, particularly in the 18th and 19th centuries, set Asia back by over 200 years. Historically, economic dominance is the leader to political and cultural expansion. Europe, followed by the US, have enjoyed this over the last two centuries. Today, Asia is in the same position as the US was at the beginning of the 20th century, economically resurgent and strong, but a political lightweight. All this will change in this century. Economic and political power will veer towards Asia, led by China and India, as we know, followed by the soft power of our ancient cultures. The world will need to learn more about the geopolitics of Asia as countries jockey for position and influence in the economic, political, and cultural spheres. Now, with this broad brush, there are underlying many fault lines, many challenges, many opportunities. To name a few, the aging population of North Asia, global climate change, global warming, the issue of the world moving towards Industry 4.0. How does Asia tackle this? which will be a world with artificial intelligence, machine learning, need for less resources in intensive manufacturing areas, and even the race for marine resources, to name just a few. I think the Rising Asia Foundation and the Rising Asia Journal, I hope, will be a scholarly and respected reference for knowledge and understanding in all relevant spheres and shape the future discourse about Asia. That's what I'm looking forward to. Thank you.
Coming to us from the fair city of Singapore is Raj Sharma, a technopreneur in his own words, a tech coolie as he calls himself, who's lived in Singapore for the last couple of decades. He has an undergraduate degree from Whitman College in Washington State in the United States, and a graduate degree from Case Western University in Cleveland, Ohio. So with that brief introduction, I shall turn it over to Raj to say a few words.
Thank you, Harish. I'm so glad to be part of this very interesting forum where I think the name itself suggests this is Rising Asia. And I think what's been said by one of the fellow team members a little earlier on, it's a bit of sort of the rebalancing that's going on from a historical perspective that we are trying to explore in terms of this millennia. As you're aware, several of you, that Asia, I guess today is Western China, I would say parts of today's Iran and Central Asia, but really the intellectual centers of excellence going back in time, right? By 1000 AD, you had a rich civilization bazaar, right, that turned the gatekeepers of the Silk Road, you had the Islamic city-states of Central Asia that were really booming along, in a very multicultural hub, as a multicultural hub of learning, right? And so really what's happening is I feel that the what used to be intellectual centers in places like Baghdad and Balkh, I would say Bukhara and even the Samarkand, that sort of were devastated after the Mongols came and pretty much ransacked wonderful storehouses of learning and dumped them in the River Tigris. I think we're seeing a rebalancing of that happening now in various ways. And I think the Rising Asia Foundation is clearly going to be a group that's going to shed some light on that and get some very interesting dialogues going in different fora. And I look forward to being part of it with all of you.
So coming to us from New Delhi is Shivang Pratap Singh. He's a member of our board of advisors of the Rising Asia Foundation. Shivang is a young advocate and a lawyer at the Supreme Court of India and the Delhi High Court. He has a degree, a law degree, an LLB from Delhi University. And his specialization is commercial law, constitutional law, and environmental law. In addition, Shivang helps us in some of our review processes for articles dealing with a legal perspective. So with that, I hand you over to Shivang Pratap Singh.
Thank you, Mr. Mehta. It is indeed an honor and privilege to be of service to the Rising Asia Journal as a member of its advisory board. It is our great fortune to have Mr. Mehta here as the editor-in-chief Apart from the wealth of editorial experience that he brings to the table, he is also an enlightened scholar himself. I have been lucky enough to get a sneak peek at the first edition of the journal, and the content, I must say, is truly state of the field on diverse subjects of relevance to the Asian landscape. I was particularly intrigued by the piece on cricket in social history written by the acclaimed novelist Mr. Zulfikar Ghosh. The quality of the content is a sign of what is to come, and I'm sure that experts and observers interested in Asia would turn to this journal on a frequent basis to enrich their studies. Being a lawyer myself, a particular area that interests me with respect to Asia is its legal systems and their relationship with the culture, politics, and governance structures. Asia is a land of ancient civilizations with unique legal systems, which are, however, not followed anymore in the strictest sense. The advent of colonialism has influenced and in most cases substituted entirely the traditional legal systems followed here. The emergence of nation states saw the installation of democratic values, which brought along Western legal systems to this land. Ideas and theories of jurists like Salmon, Austin, and Montesquieu replaced the likes of Manu and Confucius. The effects of this change are not exceedingly difficult to observe in the contemporary Asian landscape. Courts are often called upon to protect and oversee the structure of democracy here. A study of the human rights violations, attacks on press freedom, refugee crisis, and religious persecution, to name a few, are such matters where legal thought and theory can give insight to better understand them. I can say with certainty that the Rising Asia Journal will offer a wealth of knowledge in the aforesaid issues. I would like to conclude by giving my best wishes to the journal and all its members. Thank you.
And coming to us also from Calcutta is our copy editor and trustee of the Rising Asia Foundation, Raka Mukherjee, who is a graduate student of the Loretto College in Literature, pursuing her MA degree. She's published the paper called Iceberg of Innocence, a Freudian Psychoanalysis in the journal Arts Sake, and she's presented a paper called Voices of the Fair Sex of the Dark Continent, a paper on African literature. She continues to be highly engaged and deeply involved with various aspects of the foundation and the journal, like some of her colleagues. And with those words, I warmly extend a welcome to her to say a few words.
Good evening and greetings to one and all. I am Raka Mukherjee. I'm currently pursuing my master's in English from Loretto College under the University of Calcutta. It is my pleasure to speak today on the occasion of the launch of the Rising Asia Journal. Rising Asia Foundation is a dream that Dr. Harish Mehta and Dr. Bijolpita Julie Banerjee Mehta had seen together, and I am privileged to be a part of the Rising Asia Foundation Trust and as the copy editor of the Rising Asia Journal. We at Rising Asia share the vision of research and exchange of ideas all across the South Asian continent. Scholars, academics, and intellectuals, as in the words of Martin Luther King, I still have a dream, and we all have that dream of scholarship, of the celebration of knowledge and ideas and research throughout various genre. And I hope today marks the first of the many unending days when we celebrate each other, and I extend my congratulations to each member, President Dr. Sitaram Sharma, and the members of the Trust, and my fellow copy editors, the Board of Advisors, and all the scholars who will be participating and making this journal successful. Thank you so much.
coming to us from Calcutta as well is Husaina Calcuttawala, who is our copy editor on the Rising Asia Journal. She's a graduate student pursuing her MA degree in literature at Loreto College in Calcutta. Her research areas of interest are gender studies, post-colonial studies, and colonial studies. She served as one of the editors of her college magazine a few years ago. And with that brief introduction, I welcome Husaina to come forth and say a few words.
Thank you so much, sir. Hello, everybody. I'm Husaina, and I'm currently pursuing my master's in English literature from Loreto College, Kolkata. I'm an in-house copy editor at the Rising Asia Journal, and I'm so excited and grateful for this opportunity. It's been such a pleasure and joy to see Dr. Harish Mehta's vision for Rising Asia Foundation come to fruition, and I can't wait to see what's in store for everyone in the days and months to come. It's been such an enriching experience working for Rising Asia Journal and Foundation, and I'm so glad to be a part of such a journal which focuses on vital issues in the Asian region in both its collectivist historical past and its current geopolitical cooperation within the subcontinent. The academic discussions in the journal on the current political, military, societal, and economic developments in the Asia region, as well as its research articles in the field of film studies, are so interesting. And I'm greatly looking forward to reading and educating myself about diverse perspectives on the politics and policies pertaining to Asian affairs. I'd like to extend my sincere thanks to Dr. Harish Mehta and Dr. Julie Mehta for being so welcoming and kind and making this journey so exhilarating for me. I couldn't have asked for better mentors. Wishing the entire team at Rising Asia Journal and Rising Asia Foundation tremendous success in all the endeavors. Thank you.
Coming to us also from Calcutta is our copy editor and publishing executive, Roshni Subramani, who's also a graduate student doing her MA in literature at Loreto College in Calcutta. Her research areas are diasporic and Southeast Asian fiction. She's published a paper in the journal Literati on war poetry, and she's edited a student magazine appropriately called Brewing Minds. So with that, I welcome Roshni to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta, for your kind words. Good evening, everybody. I'm Roshni Subramani, the copy editor and publishing executive at the Rising Asia Journal. I'm currently pursuing my master's in English literature from Loreto College, University of Calcutta. Firstly, a hearty congratulations to one and all for the launching of the RAF, the first of its kind, if I may say. I would like to congratulate our founding members, Dr. Harish Mehta and Dr. Bijalpita Julie Mehta, on this spectacular endeavor. As the name suggests, it is indeed a celebration of Asia and its dynamic culture. The journal of its first of its kind is sure to attract scholars from various disciplines who would aim to study and collaborate on the richness and diversity of the world's largest continent, Asia. I would like to extend my gratitude to our president, Mr. Sitaram Sharma, our board of advisors, assistant editors, copy editors, who have worked effortlessly and tirelessly over the past few months for the success of this spectacular journal. In the end, I can only hope that Dr. Mehta's vision of the journal touches great heights and proves that the celebration of knowledge remains vast and never-ending. Let us keep brewing ideas and thoughts. Thank you.
And now I have the greatest pleasure in introducing the performing artist Lata Pada, a Canadian who was recently honored to become a member of the Order of Canada by the Government of Canada. She is the artistic director of Sampradaya Dance Company in Toronto, and she has several other awards. Lata is also has also presented the grand finale of this of tonight's performance is a performance by Lata's Sampradaya Dance Company in collaboration with a Balinese troupe. So it's an Indo-Balinese-Indonesian fusion dance with which we shall end off. But for now, I turn you over to Lata Pada to hear from her, her take on hybridity, her take on the diaspora, and her world of dance and performance. Well, with that, I hand you over to Lata Pada.
Warm greetings from Toronto, Canada. Congratulations on the launch of the Rising Asia Journal and Foundation, and I wish it every success. Born in India, I moved to Canada 55 years ago and also lived in Indonesia for 10 years. As a dancer, choreographer, and teacher of a classical dance form, Bharatanatyam, my work has been implicitly South Asian in aesthetic, and as a diaspora artist, it has been an imperative for me in how I have negotiated my cultural identity in a largely Eurocentric arts landscape in Canada. My role as an advocate for removing several myths and tropes about Indian dance in Canada has been a long and an arduous one. It has meant having to demystify and legitimize my dance form of Bharatanatyam as a highly systemized and developed classical system with a very strong pedagogical system, as much as ballet, and dealing with systems of inequity and lack of access of funding for culturally diverse dance communities. And as we have sought to contemporarize our dance works, we have also felt compelled to challenge being co-opted by the hegemony of Western modes of choreographic expression, but to find a genuine Asian voice and truth in our creations. Today, diaspora artists of Asian background in Canada are reaching out to our counterparts in Asia for common ground in movement vocabularies that resonate from shared cultural experience as we experiment in creative choreography that confronts gender and cultural stereotypes and also address social issues that mirror common and pressing concerns. As Asian artists trained in the classical and folk dances of our countries, we press forward with experimentation and following our creative impulses. We also deal with the nexus between tradition and modernity, often finding ourselves in the domain of hybridity, which demands strict adherence to tradition, and most importantly, an integrity, which is a shifting scale that demands much introspection and a courage to change. The Asian region is currently active and fertile with intercultural experimentation and is rightfully demanding its place on world stages. It wants to be recognized for its vitality to be current, liberated from the shackles of old and traditional, eager to encounter new audiences with fresh and audacious productions. Cross-national productions are welcomed as an opportunity to grow and to add new meaning to myths and traditions that have been celebrated for centuries. This was the genesis of my production, Pralaya. 3 years in the making, I worked with Dr. Vayan Dibya of Bali on this 70-minute work, which premiered in Canada on a 7-city tour, and later in 2019 on a 10-city tour of Indonesia and India. It is a work based on an important episode in the Mahabharata, an epic myth, eternal and revered in India and Indonesia, transformed with a new message relevant to today's global audiences. Please watch a short excerpt of Pralaya. Thank you.
There was one venerable sage, the great Vyasa, who had many a tale to tell. And so began the writing of the Mahabharata, without the weight of human prejudice, realized by the divine to benefit humankind. Thousand verses tell the tales of the Mahabharata. It is the story of the Kuru dynasty, of the five noble Pandavas, and of the 100 conniving Kauravas. These cousins, their boyhood rivalry sustained and scored, turning to deep-rooted hatred, mayhem, and gore. What did he see? This first-born Pandava, when he so thoughtlessly staked his kingdom, his brothers, and himself above all? What right did he have to stake me then, when he was just a slave? He hadn't won me. How then was I his to lose? The battlefield carpeted with crusting blood laments long and loud. It rents the air into tattered shreds of pain and mourning. Where will this end? This union of greed, hate and vengeance. Why are we made to repeat our errors in perpetuity? An endless journey, a cycle of tearing each other and the world apart. Greed begets hate and lets it multiply and sound symbols of doom across the sky. Can wisdom return? Can peace prevail? What of love? Does it not have a place? Can it not be the potent power to nourish and cherish? Should love not forgive to diminish the rancor and douse the anger? Come comprehend creation in its entirety and fathom cosmos in its enormity. Know that killer and killed are one, same as the disbeliever and devout are one. One are we, for we are they, and they are us. To come and go, and come again, when life is born, rolling and stirring, and death disarms, silver-footed and sure. It is pralaya, the end of one beginning, and the beginning of another end.
This performance of Indo-Balinese dance has put us all in a mood of looking east and acting east and furthering our alliances with our neighboring countries in order to forge greater scholarly understanding. And but of course, it will be remiss of me not to thank some few very important people who contributed to the project. Sumit Ray, who is a founding trustee with us, couldn't be here, so I must thank him for all his work. Our website developers and our software developers who put the entire journal's website together, Mr. Arithrim Basu and Ms. Shemi Sherpa, I thank them. And I thank the scholar from Jadavpur University, Ananya Bhaumik, who is our designer for our PDF pages for the journal. I must thank Mohini Maureen Pradhan, who has been very kind enough to put this entire video together for us, and our two copy editors who couldn't be here with us, and they are Hemalatha Sridhar and Miss Valentina Knotts. To them, I thank you, and without you, none of this would have happened. Good night.